Well, hello, my friends. This is Michael. Welcome back to another episode in the series of Magical Conversations. Before I begin, I want to thank each and every one of you for your kind comments. Remember, I read every single comment, and I found all of them very encouraging, inspiring, and it's given me a lot of food for thought in terms of the guests that I'd like to have on my particular show. Today's no exception. I'm delighted to introduce to you a personal friend of mine and someone who I've had the utmost admiration and respect for as a magician, as an artist, and someone who is really making a name for himself in the realm of British magic. Please welcome my guest for today, my friend James Pritchard.
Cheers, Mike. Thanks for having me.
You're more than welcome, James. Very nice to have you, and thank you for accepting my request to be on the show. Today, I'd really like to explore a number of key areas where your interest in magic is concerned. This is a very dynamic, free-flowing conversation, so I've not prepared any questions. I actually like the uncertainty of seeing where things grow and evolve in conversation. So this really is a creative conversation, okay? But before we begin, let's lay a foundation. Sure. Just introduce yourself to the community, who you are, where, what you represent, excuse me, as a professional magician and so forth.
Yeah, James Pritchard. I am a close-up magician in London. A lot of what I do is the typical kind of corporate walk-around close-up magic. That's my kind of bread and butter. And then there's the other side of the magic, which I love, is the kind of the more intimate close-up parlor magic, which are the shows that I do with Mike in the Magic Circle, for example. And those I find are my more kind of creative sort of outlets for magic.
Excellent. What you just heard James say by way of his introduction is the landscape where professional magicians now work. Cocktail receptions.
Yeah.
Most of us cut our teeth on working in restaurants. Did you have a residency by any chance?
Yeah, I covered residencies for a few friends quite regularly, and I did have one of my own for about a year.
Yes. Okay, right. Yeah. So restaurants, corporate banquets?
That's what I mostly do, is the kind of the corporate cocktail parties and dinners. That's what I do the most of. Yeah.
And we now work together as part of a team for Meet the Magic Circle close-up events every Thursday, Friday evening, which are great fun.
They're one of my favourite things. I love that.
Let's start right there. What do you like about it in contrast to the more generic professional environment?
So the professional stuff is much more, it's very functional. You know, you're there to serve a purpose. You're there as the icebreaker for the guests when they walk in, to get everybody smiling, having a good time. But it's very much kind of, it's a business. You know, you're there to just do a few quick tricks, get, you know, make them laugh, entertain them, and then move on.
Right. Let me ask you, how do you feel about approaching people cold?
I'm fine with it now. I think I've been doing it for a while. I think in the early days it probably was something that was quite intimidating, and you try all the different introductions, you know, silly things. Like, I used to introduce myself with, like, I used to go up with a fire wallet, you know, to get people's attention, anything to go, or a silly line, all kinds of stuff. And now I'm just much more relaxed, and I go to people and say, I'm James, I'm a magician.
Just by way of example, what would be your opening lines if you were to approach, say, a group of four people, two men, two women?
I treat it these days, I used to do it like I am a magician, kind of going up and I do like the big, try and go for the big impact. Now I treat it much more as if I'm one of them.
Excellent, I'm glad you said that. I hope you heard what James said. He functions as if he's a member of the event, not necessarily the magician.
That's much more effective, I think.
Do you find that the people then are taken by surprise when they realise you're a magician?
Oh, absolutely. I think when I walk up to them, they think I am one of the delegates. They think I'm a guest there. So as soon as I say I'm a magician, there's a little element of surprise, a little bit of intrigue, and it's a good opening.
I'm really glad you brought this up, because I'm going to say something quite honest here. I used to hate approaching people cold. Hated it. To me, it was alien to the way that I was brought up. Magician walks out on stage. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the show. The audience come to see a show. Today's magician, we go to where the venue is, where the audience already are. We then have to break into their group, build rapport, establish a connection and conversation before the magic begins. Mm. It's not easy. And you used a very key phrase there. You found it quite intimidating. Goodness.
Oh, yeah.
Can you imagine how I felt?
Yeah.
I hated it. I've got to tell you a true story. I used to work the football grounds.
Oh, yeah.
Emirates Stadium. And it was such a classy environment. I thought, how can I disturb these people? They're having a nice meal. What right do I have to disturb them to show them a card trick? Did that thought ever cross your mind?
I think I was just... stuck in my own nerves back then. I'm not even sure I was thinking that. I think it was just nervous about, you know, how am I going to do it? How are they going to react to me? And as a performer, I used to then be not physically aggressive, but more aggressive in my manner, because I think, which is a way of me dealing with my nerves. So I would go in with kind of guns blazing, with the fire wallet, or with a kind of what I thought was a funny line, something to just kind of try and hit them hard. That was my thinking.
Do you know what? I'm listening very carefully. You used the word aggressive. I would never have used that word to describe James. He's far from aggressive.
No.
However, no. What's interesting is I can picture you in that environment and forcing your way in. Boom, flash, fire, everybody's attention. Just as about there, put food in their mouths.
Yeah.
Right, so this is really interesting, because I hope you're all listening very carefully to this, because would I be correct in saying we are in a people business?
Very much.
Right, and in a people business, what does that mean to you?
It's building connections.
Can you say more about that?
Yeah, it's, you need to, your audience, it's, I've heard you use this word before, vulnerability.
Right.
I think that's what's important, is you have to relate to your audience and they have to relate to you. You have to see each other as humans, you know, but before any magic, you know, you have to have that kind of connection. I mean, and magic helps to build that. It's a great tool for that. But it's much more about building a connection between you and your audience, whereas before I would just kind of force myself on them.
Did you find it easy to build a connection?
I do now. Back then, no. You know, back then, I think they were just kind of a bit taken aback and a bit shocked by the whole thing. You know, it was the wrong kind of approach.
Correct me if I'm wrong, because I put myself in this situation where you are. I had no training in what it means to build a connection with people I don't know. We had no training. The only training we had was how to learn to do the tricks.
Yeah.
And did you feel that you were thrown in at the deep end when you started your professional career?
Oh, very much. Because you go in there having, you know, I'd learnt the tricks and the sleights of hand, and I'd been doing that for quite a long time before I started performing. And so I thought I knew magic, and until you're then in that situation of you then have to start from scratch, of, yeah, build that rapport with an audience, approach them, build rapport. And yeah, it felt like very deep water. You know, I didn't know what to do.
I'm going to throw something out on a limb now. Imagine you're in front of an audience right now. Would you feel confident standing there, doing nothing, but just talking for, say, 2-3 minutes before any magic has taken place?
As long as I'm prepared, as long as I have a subject in mind that I'm prepared to talk about.
As an example, what kind of subject would support you?
If this is a magic performance, it may be giving some background on myself. You know, it may be, yeah, talking about how I got into magic, my experiences, you know, some stories around my experiences in magic to help set the scene.
Okay.
And I'd be comfortable talking about that for, yeah, a couple of minutes before doing a trick, and I think that can work very well.
You've just triggered a thought for me. What does magic mean to you?
It's a feeling. You know, it's magic doesn't have to just be magic tricks. Magic is that feeling that you've experienced something rare and very special.
An emotional state.
I consider it an emotional state.
As a result of something you've experienced.
Yeah, something special and I think rare and unusual.
Excellent. Let's just park tricks for the moment. Think about a time in your life where you had that kind of experience. I can remember one experience. I'll share mine in a moment, but I want to hear from you. Can you remember a moment in your life where you had an experience where you literally felt something amazing?
I've had it with magic and non-magic. So, I mean, I think my first magic reaction like that was a children's entertainer. Was having a, when I was about 4 or 5, having a magician at my birthday party. And having them just do these amazing things. I think he just did a, you know, did it seems simple to us now, but a dove pan and you produce some popcorn. But right. to me, this was the most amazing thing. And
okay.
He saw some of my toys around the room and he put them in his hand and they disappear. And I thought, yeah. If I could do these things.
Did the magic feel real?
It felt absolutely real.
How old were you?
About 4 or 5.
Right, that's a good age to see a magician.
And I thought, if I could make popcorn appear and make things disappear, you know,
and
I'd be amazed.
When was the time you had a similar experience, but it wasn't a magician that provided it for you?
Non-magic experiences like that, I think it can be watching amazing performances, all kinds of amazing performances.
For example?
Like, I love Cirque du Soleil.
Cirque du Soleil?
Yeah.
Good choice.
Every year, it's a tradition. My mum and my sister, we go and see Cirque du Soleil. We've been doing it for years.
Albert Hall?
At the Albert Hall.
Right.
Yeah, again, I mean, and that's important too, because that makes it magical. They used to do it in a big top theatre at Battersea Power Station, and to me it wasn't the same.
So you're talking the ambiance and atmosphere of the venue.
That's a very big part of it. I mean the show itself is absolutely breathtaking, and that really feels like magic to me. But then also within that environment of the Royal Albert Hall is just...
There's a lot to unpack with what you just said there. The venue where we perform our show has a big impact on how the audience is likely to perceive us. Have you read Strong Magic?
Yes, I have, yes.
Do you remember the chapter on prestige?
It's
right at the beginning.
Okay.
Strong Magic. Read the chapter on prestige. This is where Darwin Ortiz talks about building up your prestige before the audience arrives. Okay?
Right.
Maybe they've gone to your website. They've seen testimonials of your work. They've seen a sample video. When they arrive at the venue, there's a big poster at the door featuring tonight James Pritchard, Michael Vincent.
Yeah.
The Magic Circle have worked very hard to give all the performers a certain amount of prestige.
Yes.
With that big, beautiful digital display they've got.
Yes.
Right. So yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, 100%.
So I can now understand why those Friday night events are so important, because we've got the backing and the prestige of being Magic Circle members.
Yes.
So, in your mind, James, those Friday nights, do you feel that the audience has come to see you? They may not know you're on, but
yeah.
they've come expecting to see great magic.
Oh, yes. I think they're very intrigued by the whole world of magic. And again, that's the great thing, again, like you're saying, the surrounding of the Magic Circle. Before they even get there, I think they feel like they're walking into Hogwarts.
Absolutely.
They've got this feeling of excitement and intrigue about not just the magicians, but also the setting there. You know, the world-famous Magic Circle.
Now that you've said that, when you get ready on a Friday night to go to the Magic Circle, what's going through your mind during your preparation?
I'm thinking about my whole set list, you know, so I'm thinking about what I have to be saying, what I have to be doing, I'm trying to reenact the whole thing.
And what's going through your mind about you, your commitment and your performance?
So I'm thinking about the basic things of, you know, what I'm going to say and what I'm going to do, but also just my manner and my energy to make sure that I'm going out there being relaxed. I'm making eye contact, I'm engaging, I'm building that connection.
Excellent. What I'm hearing is a lot of consideration to how the audience perceives you.
Absolutely. And that beginning, that introduction, I'm thinking about how am I going to walk on, who am I looking at, where am I looking, what's going to be the first thing I say, where am I going to stand, all of these things. And I play around with those sometimes to try and
Excellent.
Find what's going to work
Excellent.
Best.
Right, I'm really hearing this whole consideration for how the audience perceives us, because if you're working in an environment that has a lot of history, a beautiful ambiance, and a perfect setting for good quality magic, I know for myself, it's my responsibility to match that.
Yeah.
We've got to match their expectations of the venue.
I know you've put a lot of thought into your introduction. How
right.
did you come to your introduction?
Well, very simple. I woke up one morning and I lost my hearing. And once I overcame the shock of being a deaf magician, I asked myself, how can I use this? How am I going to function? I used to remember a joke that Patrick Page used to tell when he came on. Good evening, can I hear your round of applause again, please? And they would clap. So I have no shame in saying this. I've added something to that line. I say the line, and then I flinch, and then I start playing with my hearing aids. And then I say, I've got these new hearing aids, and they're very sensitive. Do you know what's beautiful about that introduction? I've taken Patrick Page's gag to the next level.
Yes.
But more importantly, I've added something authentic to it.
Yes.
I'm deaf. The audience knows I'm deaf, and they experience me handicapped.
Yeah.
And to experience another human being as handicapped triggers depth of compassion, because they experience me being vulnerable.
Mm.
Can you imagine being vulnerable within the first 20 seconds of your opening?
Mm.
Guess what happens next? I hit them hard with a strong piece of magic.
Yes, you do.
What's going through their mind? Wow, a deaf magician. Wait a minute, how the hell did he do that?
Yeah.
Right, I've got their attention. So, James, I love the way you come on and introduce yourself. It's very calm, it's quiet, it's peaceful. Just remind me your opening trick again. I think you did something with the aces. I can't remember.
Yeah, I've been playing around with that, but yeah, the opening now is a sort of ace cutting production.
So, demonstration of skill, right?
Yeah, a combination, a bit like a kind of Darwin Ortiz, that kind of thinking of the skill magic combination.
You know, I find interesting. This is just a concept I'm playing with. When a magician walks out on stage, his conduct, his being, the way he looks at the audience, and this is all before he has spoken, the audience are psychologically preparing themselves for what they most likely expect from that particular individual.
Yeah.
So James, you come on, friendly, warm, engaging, acceptable.
Yeah.
The last thing they're going to expect is that high level of skill within the first 2 minutes.
Absolutely, yes.
Hits them right between the eyes.
Yeah.
But it's an authentic opening. And guess what? Within 2 minutes, you've got their respect.
Yes. And I want it to be that balance between they know they're seeing some good magic and it's skillful, but it's not, I don't want them to feel, it doesn't feel like it's me showing off.
Exactly.
My idea is we're together, you know, I'm with them. We're together on this kind of magical journey and
right.
We're going to have fun with it. I'm not showing off to you. We're just creating an experience.
Wonderful. Together. You've just triggered a question. When it's showtime, two questions. What do you want them to say about you and your performance when it's over? Mm. And how do you want them to feel?
Yeah, I mean, I want them to be fooled and amazed. That's how it goes without saying. But also, the feedback I've been getting lately, which I really like, is that people are finding me very relatable. You know, they say that there is a genuine feel, an authenticity, something genuine about me and my magic, and I think I like that, and I want to pursue that further.
And the proof is in the pudding. They would feel comfortable inviting you to their home.
Yes. Yes, I like after the shows now. Sometimes during the interval or at the end, that people are having a drink in the bar, and I'll go down and I'll have a chat, and it's very nice. You know, you can see there. It's almost, you know, we've barely spent any time together, but already it's kind of like we're friends. You know, which I love that. You know, we've made a room full of friends together.
Excellent, excellent. How long have you been professional now?
I guess about 15 years.
15 years.
Yeah, either professional or semi-professional.
Okay. So, throughout those 15 years, can you single out one highlight moment for you that will be a lifelong memory?
The circle shows to me represent probably the highlights.
The circle shows
to me are really what it's all been building towards, you know. So, I mean, I love it, all of it, you know. The corporate side isn't necessarily as creative, but it's very fun, and it's great, you know. I've built up a lot of experience.
Takes a bit more energy as well. A
lot of energy, because you've got to sell yourself. You're there for 2 or 3 hours normally, and you've got to kind of really go in there and sell yourself.
Right.
Like each group. So it's a tiring thing. And I used to do a lot of cabaret magic as well. And again, I still had those nerves, where I would be quite aggressive in my manner, going up on a stage and you can't see the audience out there. And, you know, I would be, again, I still had that more kind of aggressive attitude where I'd do the fire wallets and flash paper and probably swore a bit and was quite, yeah, it's slightly aggressive in my manner, but that was really just disguising my nerves. And it's now that I feel I'm at a stage where I'm doing the magic that I really like, and luckily in a venue that I love as well. So to me, these circle shows, I feel, are the coming together of, I'm at a stage where I'm a lot happier with myself as a performer. I've got a kind of a style that I think is much more my own, and this wonderful setting.
I was in Holland a few weeks ago. I went there to see David Benn.
Fantastic.
Excellent magician. Mm. David said something that really resonated with me. He said that we have to work so many different kinds of venues, and those different venues dictate the kind of magic we can be successful with. So entertaining a table of 10, for me, is not close-up magic, it's stand-up. And you've got to play to the big table. And all of the magic happens within this frame.
Yeah.
That's why I used to do free fly, the bill switch. I used to bend a spoon. That would be my set.
Yeah.
And then I'd go back after the main course. A cocktail reception, all the magic came out of my pockets.
Yeah.
I would do magic with business cards, coins. I wouldn't always start off with card magic. Mm. I didn't start feeling like an artist until I did the circle shows. This is where we get 25 minutes. And you've got to hold an audience for that length of time. Mm. Can you remember the first time you did one of those shows?
Yeah, it's terrifying. Yeah, because it is so different. It is so, yeah, that idea of, yeah, you've got a small group, well, 20 or 30 people or whatever it is, watching you just talking and performing for 25 minutes. Whereas before, yeah, close-up walk-around magic, you can just kind of machine gun your way through it, like just trick after trick.
Here's the contrast for you, James. I wonder if it occurred to you. When you approach a group at a cocktail reception, you're on high energy, and you make a good reaction. You've now got to go and repeat that same high energy with a different group.
Oh, yeah.
Imagine if you had to do your act for 5, 6, 7 different groups of people in an evening. Mm. You'd be shattered.
Oh, yeah.
Exhausted.
Yeah.
That's why cocktail receptions, I try and convince the client, I don't do more than 90 minutes.
Mm.
How many people? 300. Okay, 90 minutes. Everybody will see some magic.
Yeah.
And I'll be done.
Yeah.
Because by 90 minutes, guess what?
Yes.
Too much booze.
Yes. There's a sweet spot there, isn't it? Yeah.
That's
yeah.
the phrase, sweet spot.
Yeah.
How long? One client actually asked me, Michael, what do you think is an adequate time that you should be doing this? I said to her, 90 minutes, no more. But I did ask her how many people. She said 300. Okay, this was for the Guardian newspaper. Did their Christmas party. I stayed a bit longer just in case. But my instincts told me, too much booze now.
Yes.
Done.
Yeah.
So you understand this.
Absolutely.
Let me ask you, given everything that you've shared, what would you like the listener to take away from your contribution today?
I think it's to have some magic that is your own and that you love. For a long time, I did just do the corporate walk-around magic, which is fine. You know, I do enjoy that in many ways. But it's much more functional. You know, I'm doing magic that really anybody could be. You could replace me with a lot of other people. You know, it's not particularly personal. And as a result, for a while, I became quite cynical about magic. You know, I stopped enjoying it. Because it didn't feel like anything personal. It's just kind of a bit autopilot. I'm doing the same tricks, I'm saying the same things, and anybody
could sounds like it. You hit a plateau.
Very much so.
And you weren't growing.
Absolutely,
right.
Absolutely. Which was for me, I started to wonder, you know, why am I doing this? It's just for the money. Why am I doing this? And then through things like the circle shows and also just personal circumstances where it meant I couldn't go out and perform so much. I started to just do magic for myself, learn pieces of sleight of hand or routines that at the time didn't necessarily seem practical. I didn't really know if or where I'd be able to use those. But I just enjoyed them. I had an interest in them.
Was the Travellers part of that period?
Travellers was one of those. The things like Travellers was one of those. Call to the Colours was another one, where they were just things that interested me and I wanted to learn.
I should point out, James features Call to the Colours and Travellers in his show for lay people. And trust me, it's fantastic. You don't have a video online, do you?
No.
Well
no,
then, you've got to come to London and see him perform. Trust me, it'll be well worth it. Okay, so let me ask you, what's your downtime like? Do you have any other hobbies?
Yeah, I love, I keep pretty active. I like kind of health and fitness stuff.
So you're in the gym regularly?
I'm in the gym regularly. I like boxing.
Do you box?
Yeah, I box a bit, obviously not to... Just kind of technical kind of sparring, nothing too heavy, but yeah, I like boxing, yeah.
So it's a great science, isn't it?
It's fascinating. Yeah. I love it.
Excellent. Yeah. Okay, so keeping healthy, obviously you're a family man, so you've got that responsibility.
Yeah, that's a big part of my life as well. I've got 6-year-old twin boys, so yeah, that's another big part of my life.
Do they like magic?
They like magic in like the kind of Hogwarts, you know, they think, you know, they still want real magic, you know, so, one of them has a little, he has a magic set and a little bit of an interest, but I think to him, he wants real magic.
I think they're still at the age where it might be real.
Yeah, exactly. They're not interested in my stuff. They want a dragon to walk through the door, you know.
So what does the future hold for James Pritchard Magic?
Just to keep growing, I think. Yeah, I don't really know. I don't have a specific idea exactly of what I'm going to be doing or where. But in recent years, I've spent a lot more time practicing, working on pieces of sleight of hand or routines and presentations. And I think about that a lot more deeply than I used to. And I know I'm a better magician now than I was, say, 6-7 years ago. And I just hope that you know, in another few years down the line, I can look back and say I'm a better magician
Excellent.
Than I am now.
What are your favourite books on magic?
A whole mix of books that I kind of dip in and out of. Some of them, the best magic books I ever read were by Bob Cassidy.
Mentalism?
Yeah, the Artful Mentalism of Bob Cassidy, I thought were fascinating.
You had the original books?
Yeah, I mean, I got the compilations.
I'm jealous because I've been trying to get a copy.
Oh, I'll lend you one. No problem.
I love Bob Cassidy.
I think fascinating. Yeah. I mean, I'm not a mentor, I'm a card guy more than anything, but I love his material is so strong, but I love the way his books are written, where... It's strong material, but it's combined with story. It's partly autobiographical. Talks about story, his experiences of performing, and his life, and his general thoughts on magic. And I think the way those books are written are just a really good template for how a magic book should be written. You know, it's everything.
He's one of the most convincing mentalists I've ever seen.
Oh, first time I saw him,
eerie.
Oh, blew my mind. Yeah. I thought it was
fourth dimensional telepathy.
I could not explain it. Yeah.
Stunning.
Sure. Yeah.
Let me ask you, if you could go back in time, can you name a few magicians that you would love to have seen?
I would have loved to have seen René Levent live.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good choice.
I think he was, again, seeing him as a kid on TV, he was somebody who...
Was that the Paul Daniels show?
Definitely Paul Daniels. Did he do Best of Magic as well?
Yes.
I definitely saw him on Paul Daniels.
Best of Magic. No, Heroes of Magic.
Is it Heroes of Magic?
John Fisher, yeah.
Oh, okay, yeah. So seeing him on shows like that, I would have loved to have seen
Anybody
him.
Else?
I saw him lecture. I didn't really see him perform, but I love Tom Mulliker. Tom Mulliker may be my favourite magician of all time. I think he was just brilliant.
Very original with that act.
So original, so funny. I think combined magic and comedy, I think, which is obviously a very difficult thing to do.
And equal measure too.
I think he got it right.
Right.
Yeah.
And anybody else you can think of?
Would like to have seen Ricky Jay.
Ricky Jay.
Yeah, if I could have seen 52 Assistants live, I think...
Did you ever see it on YouTube?
I've seen it, yeah. I've watched
it. What, the live show?
Yes, yeah.
Did you know it appeared in London?
I did. I did hear that.
At the Old Vic.
Did you get to see it?
I did.
Oh, amazing. Amazing.
Superb.
Yeah.
Absolutely superb.
Yeah.
In fact... The first half of the show was the best 45 minutes of card magic I've ever seen as a theatrical presentation.
Yeah.
And it covered all genres of gambling, magic, storytelling, cheating. It was magnificent.
Yeah.
And I have to say, his Cups and Balls is probably one of the best presentations I've ever seen.
Yeah.
Original, creative. He called it the history lesson.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Yeah. You've seen the video, so
yeah,
on YouTube. It's there in full. But it's edited, so there's bits missing.
Right.
So,
do you have any other favourite magicians that you've seen?
Me?
Mm.
Well, James, just consider, I came into magic late, but my interest was triggered around 1974. I saw David Nixon, Fred Capps, Doug Henning.
Mm.
And then by 1978, I saw Slidini, all on television.
Right.
Alan owned a magic shop in Holborn.
Yep.
He became my mentor. Alan introduced me to Slidini. So I met Slidini one-on-one, spent 4 days with him.
Wow.
Changed my life. Yeah. So all the magicians that I read about were still alive. I met all of my heroes, with the exception of Ed Marlowe and Fred Capps.
Yeah.
I would love to have spent time with Marlowe and seen Fred Capps, but I met everybody else. Nice. Rene Levan, Ricky J on a few occasions,
yeah.
Harry Lorraine, Derek Dingle, right. Larry Jennings, Bruce Savon, Martin Nash, all the great card men.
Wonderful.
Martin Nash. He was one of the greatest presenters of card magic I've ever seen.
Yeah.
I saw his act live at the Magic Castle.
Wow.
Ovation act.
Great.
Yeah.
Great.
And Michael Skinner.
Yeah.
An absolute gentleman.
Yeah.
He said something to me, which you remind me of. Fool your audience. Fool them badly. But be nice about it.
Yes.
Be nice about it.
Yeah.
That was the mark of a classy gentleman.
Yeah.
So, James, before we wrap up, I'm going to do a rapid-fire question as they come to me. Just a bit of fun, okay? And then we'll bring this to a close, okay?
Okay.
So, what's your favourite meal?
Japanese.
Japanese?
Yeah.
Sushi?
Sushi, yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
And do you like music?
Yes.
Who's your favourite artist?
Overall, I listen to a lot. David Bowie, if I were to choose someone.
Excellent. Have you heard Young Americans?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Young Americans.
Yeah.
My favourite singer was Luther Vandross. And if you listen carefully to Young Americans, you can hear Luther Vandross in the background.
I remember you telling me, I didn't know that. Yeah.
Excellent, we got that in common.
Yeah.
When it comes to non-magic books, what would you say is one of the best books you've ever read?
Oh, non-magic books. I love anything by Oscar Wilde. My grandmother used to read Oscar Wilde to me, and I love Oscar Wilde material.
Oscar Wilde?
Oscar Wilde.
Which one?
I love his children's stories.
He's
got these beautiful children's stories.
Which one?
There's a whole host. There's one called The Little Prince. Not so many people know them. They're these beautiful stories that my grandmother
used to read
to me.
I didn't know you wrote for children.
Yeah. Yeah,
I like the story of Dorian Gray.
Dorian Gray's a wonderful one. That's one of my favourites. But yeah, what stands out for me is these Oscar Wilde children's stories.
Wow.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Do you believe in alien life form?
I'm very on the fence on that one.
Okay.
It's possible. I don't know. I can't say I do, but I definitely can't say I don't.
A friend of mine once said, "Mike, we have to be pretty arrogant to think, given 4.4 billions of years, that we're the only life form in the universe."
Yeah, I think it's entirely possible. Yeah.
Life form.
Yeah.
All right, okay. What about sport? I know you like boxing.
Yeah, boxing's the big one for
me. Who was your favourite fighter?
Yeah, there's a few of them. I love Roberto Duran.
He's middleweight division?
All kind of the early days when he was kind of like lightweight, welterweight. He was just
devastating. So would you say Duran was your favourite?
He's definitely one of them. Maybe Tyson.
Yeah.
I when I was a kid, Mike Tyson was just this more than a man.
Different level.
Force of nature, just extraordinary.
If I had to choose one.
Yeah.
If I had to answer this question, maybe 20 years ago, without question, I would have said Ali.
Yeah.
However, today,
without
hesitation, my favourite boxer of all time was Marvin Hagler.
Ah, yeah, great choice.
Marvelous Marvin.
Yeah, amazing.
We'll get into that another time. Okay. Final question. I want you to imagine you are in front of your dream audience. And in this audience are people that you care about, both in show business, magic, family, friends.
Yeah.
And this is the performance of your life. And you have to perform one routine. That's one of your personal favourites. What routine would you perform for them?
What would I do? Put a call to the colours.
That would be the one trick.
I think I would do my call to the colours. I think it's a... I love it. It's a classic routine. Again, well, I saw Kevin Ray do a long time ago, and that really spoke to me. But I think I've added enough to it to make it my own as well.
What is it about the effect that appeals to you so much?
I don't know. It's just something that as an effect, it really interested me, and as a sleight of hand artist, it interested me. And I didn't think it would connect with an audience the way it does, but I think the way I found a presentation and maybe just the simplicity of the effect itself, I found gets a very strong reaction from an audience.
What's interesting about your choice, it's a demonstration of skill.
Yes, yeah.
But it looks and feels magical because all you're doing is dealing cards on the table.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm going to ask you a straight question. In the beginning, would you say you appeal to it purely because of the technical requirements?
I think so, yes.
But now it's become a theatrical piece in your show.
Yeah, and that's what I think. You have to have some magic that is just for you and that you love. Because you might just find that because of your connection with that material, your audience then has a connection. You then connect with your audience in that way.
You've just said something very interesting. Listen carefully. Every routine I present in my show, I love 100%.
Yeah.
Equal love. None high, none low, every routine. And my audience can feel my joy for every routine.
Yes.
Now, the fact that I love every routine the way that you love yours, it stands to reason the audience are going to be curious about why is this man so joyful?
Yeah.
If you don't feel the magic in what you're doing, they're not going to feel it. At the very least, the audience is not going to connect with who you are and why you're doing what you're doing. Why? See if this applies to you, James. When you're performing magic, do you want the audience to feel why magic is important to you?
Yes. They need to learn something about me.
Right.
You know, and that's one of the big differences between the kind of the walk around corporate stuff and the close-up shows is that... They're learning something about me, you know, and that's how one of the ways of building the connection, you know, you're sharing part of your humanity.
What do you want the audience to learn about you?
A lot about my passion, you know, my passion for magic, and why taking them into the interesting aspects of me, you know, that I'm part of this magical world, which is fascinating, and bringing them into that, letting them feel, you know, that excitement of why I love magic.
This is very good. So, you know what? This just strikes a nerve with me because this is something I remember Steve Jobs talking about. Life is very short. Spend your time doing something that you love, something that you would get up every morning to do, even if you had no concerns over money ever again. It all begins with joy and passion for the subject matter. And if the wind is in the right direction, you just might become successful at it.
Yep.
But passion for the subject. I love magic as a subject. To be honest, it's the only subject matter that interests me. I'm not interested in anything else apart from photography.
Yeah.
But here's the interesting thing. Studying magic has opened doors to other subject matters, which I have become interested in. Why? It helps me to be a much more effective magician. Storytelling, psychology, personal development, recording this podcast has helped me to become a better communicator.
Yeah.
Why? Because I want to reach my audience.
Yeah.
Makes sense? Graphic designing, Photoshop, studying photography has taught me so much about how to compose card magic, composition. So James, this is really excellent. Let's both leave the viewer with one final message before we wrap up.
For me, it is this point of having passion for what you do. I think that's the most important thing. You know, do the magic that you know. You've got to do if you're a working pro, you're just going to have to do the bread and butter stuff. But I think make sure you've got space for things that you love,
that you enjoy,
interest you. To me, that's the most.
And I'm really hearing this keeps your interest and passion healthy.
That's really changed my relationship with magic, because there was a time when I really lost it, you know, and particularly during lockdowns when I wasn't performing so much, and I really became quite negative. There was even a time when I wasn't sure I'd do any more magic.
Right,
you know,
right.
I thought maybe magic isn't for me anymore. Mm. I've done it.
Right.
And I think a lot of that was because I wasn't doing magic for me. I wasn't doing magic I loved.
Mm.
So then slowly getting back into that has been a big turning point.
That's worth fighting for.
Yeah, that's changed my relationship with magic and, you know, made me love it again.
Excellent. Thank you. So, my friends, you've heard from my friend James Pritchard. He's a very passionate man about the subject of magic. I only wish you could be here on a Friday to see his show. I know you wouldn't be disappointed at all. As for myself, I'd like to leave you all with one final thought. Think about your relationship with magic. Why do you do it? Why is it so important to you? Is it just the tricks? Is it the performance? I don't know what you can add to that or how you can answer that, but get out your notebook and start writing down your thoughts and feelings about this subject, because once you get clear for yourself as to why you're doing it, it can transform your entire relationship to the subject. And not only that, your performance becomes a vehicle for your honest, authentic self-expression. This is Michael Vincent with another episode of Magical Conversations with my friend James Pritchard. Thank you, James.
Thank you, Mike.
We look forward to seeing you all very soon. Bye for now.